رحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما صليت على آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما باركت على آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد، إن شاء الله this is our second session going through the book, the explanation of Hisn al-Muslim, the explanation of the fortress of the believer. And in the last time we went through the section, and that's the first section that the author started the book with, and that is summarizing the benefits of dhikr. And I think we reached the point number 40. So today we start with point number 51 of 41 of the benefits of dhikr. He says that a dhikr is equal to hitting with the sword in the way of Allah. It is equal to spending the money, and it is equal to also donating horses in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يعني you donate horses so that riders can ride them to fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-dhikr is equal to that. Anyone can remember a proof for this? Anyone can remember a proof that al-dhikr, one of its benefits, is that it is equal to fighting in the way of Allah, and it is equal to giving, riding animals for the mujahideen, for those who strive in the cause of Allah, to ride on that. And it is equal also to spending the money. Spending the money in the way of Allah. I will let you think about that till the end of the session, inshallah ta'ala. طيب. Benefit number 42. And this should ring a bell to those who went through the final test, right? It says, أَنَّ الذِّكْرَ رَأْسُ الشُّكْرِ, that dhikr is like the head for thankfulness, right? So meaning the chief way of showing that you are thankful to Allah is to have Allah always be on your mind and on your tongue. You always remember Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So al-dhikr, ra'su shukr, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like the head, is the chief for thankfulness or showing gratitude, being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, فَمَا شَكَرَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى مَنْ لَمْ يَذْكُرْهُ. So the one who does not remember Allah, he is not from those who offer thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who does not remember Allah, he did not really thank Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to be thankful, you need to mention Allah always. Point number 43 of the benefits of dhikr is that the most honored of the creation in the sight of Allah, or for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the believers, the most honored from the believers with Allah are those whose tongues continue to be moist by or of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, for Allah Azza wa Jal made that servant one who establishes His commands and His prohibitions. So the servant, that servant of Allah, he is carrying out Allah's orders, he's staying away from His prohibitions, and he made the dhikr of Allah, he made the remembrance, Allah's mention, he made it his sign or token. And التقوى أوجبت له دخول الجنة. Also piety necessitated for him entering into paradise and being saved from the fire. Point number 44. Benefit number 44, he says, in the heart there is hardness, there is rigidity, qaswa, toughness, hardness, rigidity. There is this thing in the heart, hardness, harshness. Nothing removes it except the remembrance of Allah. So this benefit is remembrance of Allah removes hardness of the heart. A man said to Al-Hasan Al-Basri alayhi rahmatullah, Ya Aba Sa'id, ashku ilayka qaswat qalbi, qala adhibhu bil-dhikr. He says, O Abu Sa'id, this is the nickname of Hasan Al-Hasan Al-Basri, I complain to you about the hardness of my heart. So he said to him, melt that down with dhikr, with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So remove this hardness, rigidity, right, dryness of the heart, remove that with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So dhikr removes the hardness of the heart. Benefit number 45, الذكر شفاء للقلب ودواؤه. That the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal is a healing for the heart. It is the cure for the heart. والغفلة مرضه. Being in a state of negligence, being unaware, unmindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, unmindful of the remembrance of Allah, this is the sickness of the heart. So the hearts are sick, and their cure and medicine for that is or lies in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So remembrance of Allah is a healing and is a medicine from the sickness of unmindfulness. Benefit number 46. الذكر أصل موالاة الله عز وجل والغفلة أصل معاداته. He says that remembrance of Allah is the root or is the root cause of being in alliance with Allah. Exactly like الغفلة, negligence, unmindfulness, being unaware, is the root or the chief cause of mu'adateh, the opposite of alliance, which is enmity. So remembering Allah, having Him always on your mind and on your tongue, this is the root cause for alliance with Allah. Exactly like negligence, unmindfulness, this is the root cause of the enmity between the person and Allah. The servant continues to remember his Lord up until he subhanahu wa ta'ala loves him, so he will take him as an ally. And he will continue to be negligent of him subhanahu wa ta'ala until he hates him and he becomes his enemy. Waliyadhu billah. So the root of being an ally of Allah is to remember Him. The root of, or the chief cause of being an enemy to Allah is neglecting and being unmindful of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Benefit number 47, أنه ما استجلبت نعم الله تعالى واستدفعت نقمه بمثل ذكره. That you wouldn't be able to bring about, to bring to you, to attract to you the bounties and the favors of Allah, you wouldn't be able to bring them to you with anything like his remembrance. And he wouldn't also be able to push away and repel the calamities, the problems, with anything like the remembrance of Allah. So he says, and this is, you know, we can summarize the benefit in this word, one sentence. He says, فَالذِّكْرُ جَلَّابٌ لِلنِّعَمْ دَفَّاعٌ لِلنِّقَمْ. You have ni'mah and you have niqmah. Ni'mah is a favor, act of kindness. Niqmah is the opposite of that. There's a problem, a calamity, an execution of anger, right? So dhikr brings favors and repels evils. طيب. He said, قال بعض السلف ما أقبح الغفلة عن ذكر من لا يغفل عن برك. He said that one of the pious predecessors, he said, how ugly, how horrible it is for you to neglect remembering the one who is never neglecting acts of righteousness, doing acts of righteousness towards you. How ugly, how horrible it is to be unmindful of the one who is always honoring you, who is always benefiting you, who is always kind to you. Benefit 48. الذكر يوجب صلاة الله عز وجل وملائكته على الذاكر. The ذكر, the remembrance of Allah عز وجل, necessitates the salah, the prayer from Allah, which is the praise from Allah. The prayer from Allah is praise for the servant, and also his angels. يعني the prayer of the angels is is them asking Allah to do just that for the one who is doing the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So salah from Allah is Allah praising that servant, praising him and elevating him and praising him. The angels, salah from them on the servant means that they are asking Allah to do that, yani to praise him and to elevate his status. The one whom Allah Azza wa Jal and his angels sent salah on him, then he is completely successful and he completely is triumphant. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, he mentions the ayah from Surah Al-Ahzab, the two ayat. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, dhkuru allaha dhikran kathira. All you who believe, remember Allah a lot, mention Allah much. وَسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. And سَبِّحُوهُ, glorify him, hold him to be far removed from any deficiency in the morning and in the evening. هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ. This is the third ayah. He is the one who says or sends salah upon you and his angels. So you can see the command of remembering Allah a lot, mentioning him a lot, then the result for that is that he will send down salah upon you from him and from the angels. Benefit number 49. أن من شاء أن يسكن رياض الجنة فليستوطن مجالس الذكر فإنها رياض الجنة. He says that the one who wants to live in the gardens of paradise, the one who wants to live in the gardens of paradise, then let him go to and let him be from those who inhabit or who live in the sessions of dhikr, majalis al-dhikr, sittings of remembrance, for they are Riyad al-Jannah, the gardens of paradise. There is one authentic hadith that says that about those sessions or sittings of remembrance, that they are the gardens of paradise. So the Prophet ﷺ called them that. So Al-Imam Ibn Qayyim says, if you want to be from those who are staying in the gardens of paradise on earth, then you go to the sittings of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Benefit number 50. أن مجالس الذكر مجالس الملائكة. The sittings of ذكر, they are the sittings of angels. That's where the angels sit. So there are no sittings that happen in the worldly life, right, that are places for the angels to sit, except for مجلسٌ يذكرُ اللهُ فيه, except for a sitting in which Allah is remembered. So the angels, they do not sit in any of the sittings that the human beings conduct in this worldly life, except for those sittings of remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. Then they are in there, as has come in the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَلَائِكَةٌ يَطُوفُونَ فِي الطُّرُقِ يَلْتَمِسُونَ أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. There are angels, Allah has angels, who circle the streets, who circle the streets. They seek the people of remembrance. They seek the people of remembrance. Benefit 51 of the benefits of dhikr is that Allah Azza wa Jal, He boasts the angels with those who remember Him, with the dhakirin. As has come from Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, that he said that Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, he came out on a study circle in the masjid, a circle in which Allah is remembered. So he said, what made you sit? ما أجلسكم? They said, we sat remembering Allah Ta'ala. جلسنا نذكر الله تعالى. So he said, by Allah, nothing made you sit except that. قال الله ما أجلسكم إلا ذلك. قالوا الله ما أجلسنا إلا ذلك. He said, by Allah, nothing made us sit except that. قال أما إني لم أستحلفكم تهمة لكم. I did not ask you to make an oath out of me doubting you. وَمَا كَانَ أَحَدٌ بِمَنْزِلَتِي مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَلَّ عَنْهُ حَدِيثًا مِنِّي. And no one who had my position, my status with the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, who narrated less a hadith from him than me. So he had a position with the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he used not to narrate a lot of a hadith from him عليه الصلاة والسلام. Who is it? Who is the narrator? Who? معاوية رضي الله عنه. معاوية ابن أبي سفيان رضي الله عنه عن أبي. So he came out to this circle and he says, why are you sitting? They said, we sat remembering Allah. By Allah, nothing made you sit except that. They said, by Allah, nothing made us sit except that. He said, I did not ask you to make an oath out of me doubting you. But there is no one who had my status from the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم who narrated less hadith than him, than myself, he said. But then the Messenger, so although he narrated the least of a hadith from those who had his status, he is now narrating to them, right? He is narrating to them. He said that the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came out on a circle of his companions. So he said, what made you sit right here? ما أجلسكم ها هنا? They said, جلسنا نذكر الله تعالى ونحمده على ما هدانا للإسلام. They said, we sat here remembering Allah and praising Him for what He guided us to Islam. ومن به علينا بك, and the grace, the favor that Allah granted us by you, by sending you as a messenger to us, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال الله ما أجلسكم إلا ذلك. He said by Allah nothing made you sit except that. قالوا والله ما أجلسنا إلا ذلك. They said by Allah nothing made us sit except that. So رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم then said ألا إني لم أستحلفكم تهمة لكم. He said to them surely I did not ask you to make an oath out of me doubting you. The same as معاوية رضي الله عنه said ولكنه أتاني جبريل عليه السلام وأخبرني أن الله يباهي بكم الملائكة. But جبريل came to me and he told me that Allah سبحانه وتعالى he boasts the angel with you. He boasts the angel with you. So this boasting, Imam Ibn Qayyim says, from the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a proof for the nobility of dhikr, the nobility of remembrance of Allah with him, and how remembrance of Allah is noble in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how much he loves it subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that it has a special advantage over the rest of the good deeds. Benefit 52. He says أن جميع الأعمال إنما شرعت إقامة لذكر الله. All of the actions, all of the righteous deeds, they are legislated in order to remember Allah عز وجل. So the intent, the objective behind good deeds is to remember Allah عز وجل. Allah said وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي and establish the prayer for my remembrance. Surah Taha, ayah number 14. And it has been mentioned from Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما that he was asked أنه سُئِل أَيُّ الْعَمَلِ أَفْضَلِ قَالْ ذكر الله أكبر. He was asked which of the deeds is best, so he said the remembrance of Allah is greater or greatest. He took that from the ayah in the Quran. أتلو ما أوحي إليك من الكتاب وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. It's a famous ayah. Many khatibs, for some reason, they like to use it at the end of the second khutbah. It's not a sunnah. It is okay to use it, but then use it sometimes, leave it sometimes, so that it's not like thought that it is, you know, a sunnah. And then some of them with ولذكر الله أكبر, they would say ولذكر الله, now they will أعم وأتم وأهم وأجل وأكبر, you know, they add, you know, a lot of other words with it. It's okay, but the thing is that they keep saying this as if it is part of the sunnah in the khutbah, and it is not really a sunnah to use this at every khutbah. The ayah says recite what has been revealed to you of the book and establish the salah, establish the prayers. Surely the salah, praying, that is, praying, forbids one from obscene sins and evil. And the remembrance of Allah is greater. Right? So let's go back again. Recite of that which has been revealed to you of the book and establish the prayers. Surely the prayers, it forbids one, it stops one from obscene evils or obscene sins, fahsha, and munkar, and evil. Then it says, and the remembrance of Allah is greater. Right. So, yani, the remembrance of Allah is greater. according to the explanation that Ibn al-Qayyim mentioned in his book, is that Salah has two benefits. One benefit is it will stop you from committing sins, horrible sins, obscene sins, and also committing evil deeds. The second benefit is that it will establish for you the remembrance of Allah. And by praying, you will establish the remembrance of Allah. So you have two objectives behind Salah: stopping you from obscene sins and evil, and the remembrance of Allah. And the remembrance of Allah is greater, right? According to the tafsir that the Shaykh mentioned, that the remembrance of Allah is the greater of the two objectives. طيب. Allah knows best. According to him, that is the meaning of the ayah. And from there, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he was asked, what is the best of the deeds? He said, the remembrance of Allah is greater. I think he mentioned another narration from Salman and radiallahu anhu. He was asked the same question, which of the deeds is best? So he said, don't you recite the Quran? Ala taqra'u al-Quran? Wala dhikrullahi akbar. And the remembrance of Allah is greater or greatest, right? So the remembrance of Allah is the greatest of the deeds. Benefit 53, أن أفضل أهل كل عمل أكثرهم فيه لله ذكرى. That the best of the people who do deeds or every deed are those who are most in remembrance of Allah. So he said, فأفضل الصوام أكثرهم ذكرا لله تعالى. The best of the fasting people are those who are most in terms of remembering Allah. So if you imagine a fasting person who remembers Allah not much, and another one who remembers Allah a lot, then the best of the fasting people are those who remember Allah the most. And the best of the pilgrims, Hujjaj, are those who remember Allah the most. And the best of those who donate are the ones who remember Allah the most, Azza wa Jal. And like that, the rest of the good deeds. The rest of the good deeds. There is a hadith with this meaning, and different narrations that have some weakness in it, according to some scholars, with the combining the different routes, it may get some strength and become like a good hadith or a hasan hadith. Allah knows best. But anyways, he's taking that benefit or this benefit from that narration. Benefit number 54, أن إدامة الذكر تنوب عن التطوعات. That remembering Allah, or continuously remembering Allah, it will replace the other voluntary deeds and will take their place. وتقوم مقامه. Again, continuously remembering Allah Azza wa Jal, it will replace the voluntary deeds and it will take its place. It will take its position. Whether those voluntary deeds were bodily type of deeds or financial types of deeds, or badaniya wa maliya, or bodily and financial. Who will give us an example of an action that is done by the body? Salah. And another one, reciting the Quran. Another one, tawaf, fasting, right? Those are acts that are done by the body. Financial is like zakat, sadaqah, donation, right? So those are financial. there are deeds that are both bodily and financial, with the body and the finances. Hajj. Right? So he says that dhikr, it will replace the voluntary deeds. He's emphasizing the voluntary deeds. You know, so you cannot say, okay, I've done dhikr, so I don't have to go for Hajj, you know. Right? Because I did the remembrance, and the remembrance is equal to, right? It's not, he's talking about voluntary, extra supererogatory deeds. طيب. He said, وَقَدْ جَاءَ ذَلِكَ صَرِيحًا فِي حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةِ. This has come explicitly in the hadith of Abi Huraira. Who can remember this hadith? Hadith that says that the dhikr can replace, can take the position, the voluntary good deeds, whether they are bodily deeds or they are financial deeds or a mix of both. Very famous hadith. Very famous hadith. That is the one. That the poor amongst the immigrants, muhajirin, they came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, the people of wealth, the wealthy people, they have taken all the high degrees and the endless delight, the endless enjoyment. ذهب أهل الدثور بالدرجات العلا والنعيم المقيم. They said, يصلون كما نصلي. They pray like we pray. ويصومون كما نصوم. And they fast like we fast. ولهم فضل أموال. And they have extra money by which يحجون بها. They perform pilgrimage with them. ويعتمرون. They perform umrah. ويجاهدون. And they strive in the cause of Allah. فقال, he said عليه الصلاة والسلام, ألا أعلمكم شيئا, shall I not teach you something, تدركون به من سبقكم, by which you will catch up with those who outraced you, وتسبقون به من بعدكم, and by it you will outrace those who are behind you, or who are after you. ولا يكون أحد أفضل منكم إلا من صنع ما صنعتم, and there will be no one who is better than you except the one who does like what you do. قالوا بلى يا رسول الله. They said, of course, O Messenger of Allah. So he said, تسبحون وتحمدون وتكبرون خلف كل صلاة. He said, so you say سبحان الله and Alhamdulillah and Allahu Akbar after every salah. He said, this is in Bukhari and Muslim, is a famous hadith. So he said that he made dhikr as a replacement for what they missed of Hajj, Umrah, and Jihad. And he informed that they will beat them with this dhikr. They will beat them, they will pioneer, they will outrace them with this dhikr. So those they are spending the money for Hajj, Umrah, and Jihad, and those they are doing this dhikr after every salah. Those who do this dhikr after every salah, they beat the others who are spending, right? And who are doing these bodily good deeds and financial good deeds. طيب. Benefit 55. أن ذكر الله تعالى من أكبر العون على طاعته. He said that remembrance of Allah عز وجل is from the greatest means of help to obey Allah Azza wa Jal. For it, يعني الذكر, for الذكر, يحببها إلى العبد. He makes the acts of obedience beloved to the servant of Allah. ويسهلها عليه ويلذذها له. ذكر makes those acts of obedience easy for him, and he makes them tasty and enjoyable for him. ويجعل قرة عينه فيها, and he makes his complete pleasure in doing them, in doing these good deeds. Why? Because he is remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. because he remembers and mentions Allah much, this will make the acts of obedience very easy and very beloved, and he those good deeds, they will be a source of satisfaction for him. Why? Because he is someone who remembers Allah much. Benefit 56, that the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يُسَهِّلُ الصَّعْبُ وَيُيَسِّرُ الْعَسِيرُ وَيُخَفِّفُ الْمَشَاقُ. He said it makes what is difficult easy, it makes what is hard also light, and it will reduce the difficulties, or it will reduce the hardships that one will go through. Benefit 57, that the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal, it removes from the heart all of its fears. Any fear in the heart can be removed by the dhikr. And it has an amazing effect in achieving safety and security. So the one who is afraid, the one who is whose fear has become tremendous, اشْتَدَّ خَوْفُهُ, the one who's afraid, rather he is so much afraid, there is nothing more beneficial for him than the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So al-dhikr removes the fear. Benefit 58, al-dhikr yu'ti al-dhakira quwwa. Al-dhikr, remembrance of Allah, it will give the one who does it, it will give him strength, it will give him power. حتى إنه لا يفعل مع الذكر ما لم يطق فعله بدونه. To a point that he will do, along with remembering Allah, he will do that which he is not able to do without it, without remembering Allah. He says, don't you see how the Prophet, the Messenger, صلى الله عليه وسلم, he taught his daughter Fatima and Ali, رضي الله عنهما, he taught them to say Subhanallah every night when they go to bed. They say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. When they go to bed, 33 times Subhanallah, 33 times Alhamdulillah, and 33 or 34 actually, 34 times Allahu Akbar. That is when she asked him for, what did she ask him for? She asked him for a maid, a servant, right? So she wanted, she went in specific, Fatima radiallahu anha, she went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa to ask for a servant, so that she will have that servant to help her with the different chores of the day, right? So he came, she did not find him. So he came to them at night, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he sat between her and Ali, radiallahu anhu. And he taught them this, and he said to them that this is better for you than a servant, than having a servant. She went to him, she asked him for a servant, she complained to him what she is going through, the pain that she's going through of grinding and watering and service that she's doing, those chores that she's doing. And he taught them alayhi salatu wasalam that Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar before going to bed, and he said to them, إِنَّهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمَا مِنْ خَادِمٍ. It is better for you two, the two of you, than having a servant, than having a servant. So Al-Imam Ibn Qayyim, he said, فَقِيلٌ. So it is said that أَنَّ مَنْ دَغَمَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وَجَدَ قُوَّةً فِي يَوْمِهِ مُغْنِيَةً عَنْ خَادِمٍ. He said that the one who continues to do that, he will find during the day power or strength that will suffice him, that will make him be not in need of a servant. Right? Benefit 59, أَنَّ عُمَّالَ الْآخِرَةِ كلهم في مضمار السباق والذاكرون هم أسبقهم في ذلك المضمار. there are deeds that are done for the next life. There are people who are doing deeds, performing deeds for the next life. He said, all of those doers of these good deeds are on the race tracks. Midmar al-Sibaq. Midmar al-Sibaq, you know, they have these horses and they have a track where they will run. Right? So he says, those who do good deeds in order to achieve, you know, position in the next life, they are all on the raceway or the racetrack. He said, الذاكرون هم أسبقهم في ذلك المدمار. Those who remember Allah much, they are the first and foremost in that racetrack. They beat everybody else. They pioneered it. Benefit number 60, كثرة ذكر الله عز وجل أمان من النفاق. Remembering Allah a lot is a safety and security from hypocrisy. He said, فَإِنَّ الْمُنَافِقُ قَلِيلُ الذِّكْرِ لِلَّهِ. For surely the hypocrite is one who mentions Allah very little. Allah عز وجل said about the munafiqeen, about the hypocrites, وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. They don't remember Allah except very little. Those are the hypocrites. They don't remember Allah except very little. Ka'b said, رضي الله عنه, من أكثر ذكر الله برئ من النفاق. The one who remembers Allah much, then he is free from hypocrisy. So if someone is remembering Allah a lot, then he should know, inshallah, that he is safe from being hypocritical. Right? And this is benefit number 60 that the author has basically compiled and summarized from the benefits of al-dhikr, from the benefits of al-dhikr. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, he mentioned actually more than that, but yani, inshallah, he summarized or he, you know, compiled or he gathered together the most important ones, inshallah ta'ala. After mentioning the benefits of dhikr, he moves on to mention the adab of al-dhikr and al-du'a. So we either stop here, and if you have questions that we can go through, we can do them. Otherwise, we can start with the etiquettes of dhikr and du'a. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what is that hadith? Okay, so what is the benefit? What was the benefit?
Subhanallah
equals more than 100
horses. Okay. And who can help him? Hmm? You looking for this one? Yeah, mashallah. Bismillah. Tell him what was the question. You forgot the benefit? Okay, here's one narration here.
which says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who says Subhanallah 100 times before the rising of the sun and before its setting, that will be better than 100 she camels, right? 100 camels, badana, right? And the one who says Alhamdulillah 100 times before the rising of the sun and before its setting, or its setting, then it will be better than 100 horses that يُحْمَلُ عَلَيْهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, 100 horses that you give for the warriors to ride in the way of Allah. And the one who says Allahu Akbar 100 times before the rising of the sun and before its setting, that will be better than setting free 100 necks or 100 people. And the one who says La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, 100 times before the rising of the sun and before its setting, no one will come on the day of judgment with a deed better than his deed, except the one who said like what he said, or said more, or added more than that. So that is one of the ahadith in this regard. You have to be faster than that. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. طيب there are different narrations about it. There is 10, there is 1, there is 100.
Can you repeat the last one? The one who says La ilaha illallah wa la sharika lah 100
times.
What was the reward?
Okay.
Sitting 100 people.
What is the reward?
No one come better than his own.
That's the one. No one would come with a deed better than what he did, except someone who did like it or added more than that, or did more than that. يعني الله knows best if you did this or that, as long as you reach the number that is mentioned, right? So if you reach the number, whether you say Subhanallah, 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 Subhanallah until you reach 33, then Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, or you say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, or Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, right? So if you do this or that, as long as you reach the number that is mentioned, it should be fine, inshallah. Yeah, that's the same as the brother asked. There is one, there is 10, there is 100.
Okay.
Or more than that. Right? Yes. Which hadith? لا. This one, the reference, he refers it to صحيح الترغيب 658. صحيح الترغيب 658. Doesn't mention the other references, but yes.
When they say add on top of that, does that mean that they say la ilaha alhamdulillah Allahu Akbar additionally? Does they say maybe
yes, more than 100 times.
Okay. Or does it mean like they can add other dua or other dhikr on top of that, and then it would be greater?
It's talking of the same. Did this or more? Of course, I mean that is also there. You know, who did more than that of dhikr, that is like that recitation of the Quran or whatever. Yani, but in this context, it talks about these. Allah knows best. These specific dhikr. You say that or more than that. Yes. Okay. So, what is the question in which in this regard? What he said. There are dhikr. There is a different type of dhikr that you say, and it has more weight or more reward than what you say and you repeat. So. Like the dhikr that you are mentioning now, subhanallah wa bihamdi adada khalqihi wa ridha nafsihi wa zinata arshihi wa midada kalimati. So yani that is dhikr that is compounded in terms of reward. That hadith, he said like that or said more than it. So someone would achieve the number, which is 100, and then he would say more than 100, right? Or he would say more than 100, and he would say like this one, and he would say it few times, right? So he will be adding more to it, you know. So that's the case. Allah knows best. Yes.
The last verse, it says, if you make more digging, you'll be from a thief from the Hebrews.
Mm-hmm.
What is considered the minimum remembrance of Allah, is it out of our healing, since we don't remember the dhikr of Allah, if I bring my part time and do the dhikr after the every salah, will that suffice me for the remembrance of Allah for that day, and I will be free from the hypocrisy, or if I happen to be that hypocrisy, what kind of hypocrisy is it, the hypocrisy of action or the other hypocrisy?
Here it says that if you remember Allah and mention Him much, you will be safe from hypocrisy, because the hypocrites, they don't mention Allah except very little. So that quality of the hypocrites, if you are one who mentions Allah a lot, then you will be safe, you will be safe, you will be safe, you will be secure, you will be saved from hypocrisy. Because if you mention Allah much, then you are not from them. And that's what he's trying to say here. Regarding how much is much, right? Then if you stick to the dhikr that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to do during the day, during the night, and in his salah, and going out, coming back, you know, going to sleep, waking up, the rest of, you know, your day, wearing your clothes, taking off your clothes, entering the washroom, leaving, and so on and so forth, intercourse and like that. If you follow the sunnah, then you are definitely from those who mention Allah much. Right? Allah knows best. The opposite, which is? If you don't mention Allah much, then you are not safe. You may be from the hypocrites then. Right? That's what he's trying to say here. If you mention Allah a lot, then you are out of that. Because out of that description, because the hypocrites is in the Quran, it says they mention Allah very little. So if someone mentions the mentions Allah very little, then he has that quality in him, right? Quality of the hypocrites, right? But if he mentions Allah a lot, then he is someone who is safe, he's secure from that description of hypocrisy. He's mentioning this as one of the benefits of dhikr. So if you mention Allah a lot, then you will be safe and secure from being a hypocrite, right? So this is one of the yani, benefits of dhikr. Yes. You know, I need to have eyes on my side here, so. It's all right. Tafaddal. Naam. So you're asking about hypocrisy?
Two questions. One question is people of innovation who are just doing.
Yes. Yani the dhikr that does not match the sunnah, right, is not yani counted as dhikr, right? And this is actually from the paths of the shaitan that will take one further away from remembering the true remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they are using dhikr that is legislated in the sunnah, then alhamdulillah, they will get their reward for that. If they are using dhikr that is not legislated in the sunnah, then they will lose as much, yani they will cancel some of their good deeds because of that. Right? So this is the case. Like, you know, yani the dhikr with huwa, right? He, right? Yani they think that huwa is one of the names of Allah. So they are saying huwa. Yani, first of all, this is not one of the names of Allah. It's a pronoun, right? It's not one of the names of Allah, right? So unfortunately, some masahif you will find huwa always in red, right? It's not anything special about the word huwa. It's not of the names of Allah. Plus, even the names of Allah, you do not find in the sunnah mentioning them just like that. You sit and you say Allah, Allah, Allah. Rather you say Subhanallah, or Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. All of them is a complete sentence, right? Because in the Arabic language, and even for not the Arabic language in this matter, yani, if you know, yani, you mention someone, right? Say you call him by his name or his good name, right? And you keep repeating that, this person will not view this to be any praise. If your name is Saif, so you always call Saif, 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 safe. Then they will say, well, what do you want? Why are you repeating this name? What is this? What do you want? And he's safe, safe, you are, okay, what? Bring this, give me that. What's your question? Here is this, here is that, right? But you say, safe, 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 what do you want? And there is nothing good in that, right? And they will use for their, you know, dhikr, they will chop off some of the ayat, like, Qulillah, say Allah, right? Which is actually, if you read the context, say who, and who, say Allah, is just answering that, right? And there is also a hadith which says, which they found, which says that the hour will not be established until you see, yani, that no one will be saying Allah, Allah. And in another narration, La ilaha illallah, right? So they took that Allah, Allah to use for their dhikr, which is, they know it's not legislated in the sunnah, right? So those types of dhikr that are not legislated, they are starting a way to bid'ah, which will take them further away from remembering Allah Azza wa Jal, rather than they remember Allah. You know, they are using something that will make them farther away from Him. So, yani, one of the things that are mentioned to those people is, you know that there is a dhikr that will bring you closer to Allah. There is nobody that is in doubt about that. Everybody agrees on it. Like what is legislated in the sunnah, different ahadith, Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, so on and so forth. And there is this dhikr that you are doing, the least that can be said about it, that it's iffy, you know. Some scholars said, yes, it's good. Some scholars said, it's not good. Although those scholars, whom they call scholars, are not really up to the level of scholarship. But then, this is the least that can be said about it. So why you leave something that is agreed upon and use something that the people differ about, right? So this is the case. Reciting the Quran, for instance, is the best form of dhikr. Reciting the Quran. Why leave reciting the Quran to these circles where someone is standing and someone is sitting, and who and Allah, Allah, and so on and so forth, and then like this together, and then they turn off the lights and, you know, other stuff happens, right? So this is the case. Allah knows best. Mm-hmm.
So one more thing, like you told us, like the deeds, the people who do this, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, after every salah.
Mm-hmm.
Like back home they do, after the salah, they do like la ilaha illallah 10 times. Like, is that the hadith or this made up? Especially in the Shafi'is.
They do it together?
Yeah. After the Salah of Fajr and Asr, they do it louder.
Yes. No, it's not in the Sunnah, and it's not in the Shafi'i Madhab either. Right? And as Shafi'i explicitly mentioned that, you know, the dhikr is not to be done out loud. Even what is mentioned end of the salah used to be known with takbir, and in one narration with dhikr, yani loudly. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i is known from him that he said that this Rasulullah used to teach the people in the beginning until they learned, and then he stopped. This is how he explained it. So it has nothing to do with Al-Imam al-Shafi'i himself. So this is something that they innovated, that they are doing. The origin of it, to say La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah lahul mulk wa lahul hamd wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, 10 times after Salat al-Fajr and after Maghrib, not after Asr. Right? This is legislated in the Sunnah, but each one by himself, not, you know, all together.
Mm-hmm.
after Umar radi Allah didn't pray in temple, rather he built a mosque in the area to pray. Now my question is, in this country, Muslims buying church and temple, transferring them into mosque.
Mm-hmm.
Also Muslims arranging Islamic conferences in convention centers and praying there. Also there are multi-prayer halls in hospitals and such places. What will be the ruling on praying those mosques?
يعني turning a church into a masjid, that is okay, that is good. And if an Islamic conference is held in a big hall or something, then the place they pray in is not a masjid, but it's a place where they gather together and pray. And the Muslims are allowed to pray wherever they are, as the earth has been made for me masjidan wa tahuran, as the Prophet ﷺ said, that the earth has been made for me as a masjid, a place where you can prostrate, that is, and a means of purification, meaning the tayammum. The third place that he mentions is
multi-prayer
hall. Then this is like a place that the hospital or the airport or wherever, they put that place there so that the followers of the different religions, they can find a place that is secluded where they can peacefully, you know, say their prayers. So inshallah it is okay to pray there, especially for the places where they have the place split up into a place for Muslims and others, right? Because usually Muslims are the ones who need it the most. So because they use it and they give them a special place for them. Especially they take off their shoes, they go and make wudu, they even started making them, you know, I have seen that some places, a foot bath, you know, a foot bath. So you don't have to put your foot in the sink, you know, they made for them a foot bath. It helps everybody, it helps them, and it helps the cleaners also. They don't run into problems having a lot of water, you know, splashed on the floors. So this is the case. So it's okay to use these places. The prayer is valid in these places. Right. If there is a cross that is hung on the wall or something like that, that there are places that are like this. If you can remove it, pray and then put it back or whatever, then that would be the best if you can remove it. Right. But, if you prayed while it's there, still the salah is valid. Allah knows best. And that masjid was built to harm the believers and to cause a split up between the believers. That the hypocrites, they did that. They established that place to divide and to split up, to harm the Muslim society. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he did what he did, and Allah told him, لا تقوم فيه أبدا, never stand in it. Right? So this is the case. That's very different from, you know, what the question is saying.
That the masjid is before Rasulullah reached Medina. That's the masjid.
After he reached Medina. Yes. Something else? Tafaddal. Okay. يعني they should use the Arabic language for the dhikr, as a dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. They should use the Arabic language, like Subhanallah. They shouldn't be using
you know, glory be to Allah, glory be to Allah. And they shouldn't translate it like that. They should use the Arabic words and they understand their meanings. That's what they should be using. But if they are talking in their speech, yani, they want to use, but as a dhikr, they should use the words in Arabic. Yes. Yes, hypocrisy is a big subject. He asked for other signs of hypocrisy. So who will help? Ayatul Munafiqi Thalath, the sign of a hypocrite. The signs are three. What are they? Ida, if he was entrusted with something, he does not keep the trust. He does not, he betrays. And? Okay, now we have three and we have a hadith with four. Let's go with the three only. إذا أتمنى خان إذا حدث كذب. Yes, when he speaks, he lies. He tells a lie. وإذا وعد أخلف. If he promises, he breaks his promise. Now, the other hadith mentions four. إذا عهد غدر وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرْ. These are different, right? When he has a covenant, he, you know, breaks that. And when he is in a dispute, he, what? He transgresses his limits, right? When he is in a dispute with somebody, he would, yani, transgress his limits regarding that person, right? He will not suffice himself, limit himself to the dispute, but he expands on attacking the others. So that's from the signs of hypocrisy that are mentioned in the hadith. Now there are other signs, yani, in terms of prayer, salah. They are neglectful of their salah. The hardest for them, the salah that are the hardest on the yani, hypocrites, they are salat. Which salat? Isha and Fajr, right? It's difficult for them. And they, you know, show off. That's one of the signs of, or the actions, or the acts of the hypocrites. They also hurt and harm others with the charity that they give, and so on and so forth. But we have to know that there is nifaqun akbar and nifaqun asghar. So there is major or greater hypocrisy and there is the lesser hypocrisy. The greater hypocrisy is the one that takes one outside of the fold of Islam. And this is for one not to really believe in Islam, although one is showing that he or she is a Muslim. And those are spoken about, yani, in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, right? So, and so on and so forth, yani. There are so many, yani, ayat that talk about the hypocrites and describe them in detail. You know, in Surah At-Tawbah, and amongst them, right? So this is the case. And you have the nifaq that is the lesser type of nifaq, which is, it does not take one outside of the fold of Islam, but then he would be having one of the qualities of the hypocrites. And those, just like what was mentioned, lying in speech, breaking promises, you know, transgressing the limits in disputes, and, you know, not keeping a trust, and so on and so forth. Allah knows best. That's good. That's good. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik ashhadu